morning and welcome. It is a bittersweet feeling to introduce our speaker today, who does not really need an introduction. Last year, when Dr. John Marciari gave his talk on purchasing Piranesi, buying art on the Grand Tour, he was our curator of European art and head of provenance and research at this museum. Today, however, John is an independent curator from Baltimore and Maryland, whose most recent show, Francesco Vanni, Art in Later Renaissance Siena, is currently on view at the Yale University Art Gallery, his former alma mater. Accompanying this exhibit is a handsome catalog with an essay by John, and he's writing a lot right now. Among other writing projects, he's also working on a catalog essay regarding his well-known discovery of Diego Velázquez's early Education of the Virgin altarpiece, which will open in Spain next year. But most importantly to us, he is writing the catalog of Italian, Spanish, and French paintings before 1850 at the San Diego Museum of Art. Stemming from this research, John will shed new light on works in our museum in his lecture, Discoveries and Recoveries, recent conservation work on European paintings in the permanent collection. So happy to welcome you back, John, and thanks for sharing your knowledge with us.
Well, thank you all for coming. Thank you, Ruth. Thank you, Monica, for the invitation to give the lecture many months ago and for being willing to keep it on the schedule, even though I was no longer going to be here when today came to pass. As both Ruth and Monica have said, this is a lecture related to my continuing work on the catalog of Italian, Spanish, and French paintings before 1850 at this museum, a project which I began literally the day that I started here at the museum a bit more than 5 years ago. It was the main project for which I was initially hired by Derek Cartwright, and which I've worked on and off for now 5 years, and which I am now working on full time in a way that I wasn't able to work on it full time while also tending to the collection and exhibitions. It's still some months away from completion. The manuscript is meant to be done in May. The catalog will finally be published in, we think, January of 2015 in time for all the centenary celebrations in the park. Now, a number of you have heard me speak about one or another part of this collection catalog many times before, and what I thought I would do today was take one distinct focus, which was to look at the paintings that have been through, or look at some of the paintings that have been through conservation treatments in the last 3 or 4 years, to talk about the research on these pictures, to talk about some of the discoveries that we made during treatments. And I'll keep saying we, and I will both start and end this lecture by thanking my colleagues from the Balboa Art Conservation Center with whom all of this work was done and continues to be done. I would like to talk about some of the decisions that we make in the middle of conservation treatments, where to go forward, where to stop with the restoration of a painting, to celebrate some of the successes that we've had, but also to put these in a bit of a bigger context, to talk about some of the bigger issues regarding the conservation of paintings. I'm going to focus on these handful of paintings today, although I'll go off on a number of tangents and include other things as well. None of these, and I'll identify all of these paintings as I go through them, none of these, admittedly, is among the first rank of masterpieces at this museum. Many of them are by minor masters, many are by workshops or are of uncertain attribution. Some of them have real condition issues. At least two of the pictures you see on the screen are fragments of much larger works. They're chosen not because this is a tour about the highlights of my collection catalog or the most important discoveries, but again, to highlight some of the issues in the conservation of pictures. And also in a way to advertise how the catalog will shed light on issues that go beyond these specific pictures, how in looking at these, we often find information that tells us about the careers of the artist much more generally. It's not simply a matter of telling the story of how a picture got to here and what's happened to it since. It's putting it in that bigger context. Now, I keep talking about issues in conservation. So what do I mean by this? This is a kind of shameless bit of demagoguery, I admit it, but you know, it's a case where life is stranger than fiction. I mean, this is even better than Mr. Bean and Whistler's Mother. I think every one of you, I hope every one of you will recognize the monkey Christ on screen. This is a restoration gone horribly awry that happened in Spain last year by a rather aged amateur who decided to fix up the local parish's not terribly important or very good picture of Christ. Put this out of your mind. I'm going to presume when we're talking about issues in conservation, we're dealing with trained conservators and trained curators and a basic level of competency, which is not exhibited here, however amusing that slide continues to be. What I want to talk about are what kind of methodology should we be following when we're going through a conservation treatment, or is that even the right question? Does a methodology actually steer you wrong? What's the goal in treating an individual picture? What's the goal in a series of conservation treatments for an entire collection? Do you have to treat one picture the same way that you treated the previous picture in the collection in order to create a complete set of, or an equal set of expectations in the viewers of a collection? What is an honest restoration is a question that's sometimes asked, which is a bit like asking, what is truth? This may seem as though I'm overthinking the issues a bit, but I think you need to understand the backstory, not just for me, but for really an entire generation of curators and conservators at American museums. And much of the story goes back to what happened at Yale in the 50s and 60s. Now, the Yale University Art Gallery is one of the oldest galleries in the country and has one of the biggest collections, especially of early Italian paintings. James Jackson Jarvis went off to Tuscany, raided the back rooms of convents, bought up hundreds, literally hundreds, of early Italian works. It is maybe not the greatest, but certainly the richest collection of such material in the country for the variety of artists, the variety of kinds of pictures it has. Now, in the 1950s, a man named Charles Seymour came into the story. Seymour was not the head of the museum, nor even the curator of the museum, but was rather the head of the art history department. He was a scholar of the Italian Renaissance. Perhaps equally important in the historical backstory here is that Charles Seymour was also the son of Yale's president, and so he had, well, few checks on his decisions. He had a kind of carte blanche to do what he would with the collection. And Seymour came up with the idea that what needed to be presented was only the honest truth in pictures, only the things that the artist had actually put onto that panel, or more often in early Italian, the panel or sometimes canvas, and that anything that was a later restoration needed to be removed in order for us to understand the truth of the art. What this means in practical terms. So here are a pair of panels by Taddeo di Bartolo, a Sienese artist of the early 15th century, St. John the Baptist and St. Jerome. This is how they appear in the 1940 catalog of Yale's collection. This is how those two works appear in the 1970s catalog, and this is just a color version of that same photo. So they went from being like this to being like this, with raw wood, worm-eaten back, the worm-eaten back of the panel showing gesso, all of these little flake losses left, splits, tears. What was he trying to get at? And also, it was left, the Jerome was left in its horribly restored condition, so that reading the 1970s catalog, you could see how much more wonderful this was than the way its pendant picture still remained. Now, certain mistakes were made here, mistakes that are even more obvious when you look not just at the Taddeo di Bartolo, but at this Madonna and Child, which started its life as a work by Giovanni Bellini. And admittedly, in the somewhat fuzzy 1940s photograph, it does look as though it's been Victorianized. It looks as though it's got a good deal of overpaint. But surely, the extent of Bellini's original paint was not merely this, which is how the picture looks today, about which there can be nothing done. This is the result of a methodology gone horribly wrong. This is the result of the idea that you make one set of determinations and then you force your
conservator to follow those. So Seymour said anything that was not original needed to be taken away. And as Andy Petrin, the conservator in charge of this, said, well, you know, when your boss tells you to take something away, you can't say no. You know, you have to do what your boss, who's, you know, the head of the art history department at Yale, says is right. One of the mistakes was the presumption that there was no oil paint used in Italian painting before about 1500, this kind of old-fashioned idea that oil paint starts with Van Eyck and then comes into Italy around the year 1500. So wherever an oil glaze was found, Petrin was instructed to scrape that away. Old framing members, old treatments, so that this panel, both of these panels, were part of a big polyptych, which originally had framing members covering the corners of the panel. They were never raw wood at any point in their history, but the framing members of the original polyptych had been lost, and they had been painted out, which is more or less what we would do today. The idea of showing them in this state is not accurate to how the picture was, nor does it actually tell you as a viewer, as a matter of member of the general public, anything about the picture, nor is it helpful as a scholar, because the scholar just looks and says, well, that's ridiculous, because of course that was covered with framing members. But now you're presenting this thing in this state, which seems to serve no one. Obviously, this methodology, when it runs away, gets even worse. So I think the lesson that we take away from all of this treatment, the backstory against which any conservation in America in the succeeding generation works is, you know, don't let some big idea guide your restoration. Keep certain conditions in mind, but make decision by decision according to picture by picture, because there are different issues all the time. Try to get away from this idea of pictures as documents of historical truth and acknowledge that paintings are objects in a museum which are meant to be looked at under certain conditions. Don't presume that there is a single truth, and that conservation, like art history, is not simply a scientific field. Just as art history is a kind of combination of the art of humanism and scientific rigor, so too conservation needs to kind of give and take between aesthetic values of presentation and a kind of intellectual approach to what is being done to the works. Yale in recent years has started trying to recover certain pictures. The Bellini is a lost cause. The Taddeo di Bartolo now looks, again, more or less as it looked in the 1940s, except even more of the retouching now. There's even more retouching than there was in the 1940s because so much had been scraped away and now it's to be put back. But at least you can look at the picture without wondering what machine has chewed on the panel, which is pretty much the only thing you could take away from seeing it in this condition. And there are continual challenges. The conservation campaign of the 1950s, 60s, and early 70s at Yale dealt mainly with early Italian pictures. There are other things at Yale, such as this picture, which many of you have heard me talk about before, which is now in the middle of its conservation treatment. And there are still the questions. I mean, no one is going to argue about whether you should paint out the damages from the stretcher bar. But what do you do here, where you have this ghost coming through that was actually underpaint? Originally, the head of St. Dan in this painting by Velázquez was inclined. And so this is something that Velázquez had painted over, which, as the picture was cleaned in time, has shown up again. Do you paint that out? Do you leave it as part of the history of the picture? This is horribly damaged. It's been cut at the top. You're obviously not going to try to recreate the rest of the angel because there's no photograph or any indication of what that looked like. There's a constant give and take. There's no simple answer. Now, all this, as I say, is backstory. Let's turn to some of the things that happened here or have been happening here. And fortunately, once in a while, you start a conservation treatment, more than once in a while. Sometimes you start a conservation treatment and things go more or less exactly as you planned or as you would hope. A picture like this painting of the Vision of St. Anthony by Giambattista Pittoni, it's hanging on the wall, hadn't really been treated in its history here at this museum. It's been here since the 40s. Nothing had ever been done to it. You can see in this old photo, which is slightly blurry, I realize, but I think you can get a sense from it of how yellowed the varnish was, how you couldn't, and some of you will remember perfectly well, how this picture just had this dead, lifeless, dirty yellow varnish on it. In 2009, it was requested for an exhibition on 18th century Venetian paintings, and this gave us the excuse of sending it over to BACC and having it looked at. One of the first things we needed to do was figure out how to secure it in its frame, because it was in a large, sort of overly Baroque frame that swallowed the picture, but also was too big for the painting, so that there were weird gaps, and you wouldn't send this thing to travel with the canvas kind of rattling around in the frame. So we investigated what this would look like. Could this be cleaned? And how could we secure it in the frame? And one of the most interesting discoveries was that it had, in fact, been stretched to make it fit this big, ugly frame in which it had been put when it was in the Crawford collection in Edinburgh. It was part of Lord Crawford's famous collection of works he bought on his grand tour. What you see here with the picture in its clean state before repainting are these unpainted margins that were actually the original size of the canvas wrapped around the stretcher, which someone had opened up, placed flat, and lined with another canvas, and then painted out so that the outside inch and a half on either side of this picture was pure fabrication made so that it would almost, but not still not quite, fit this big frame that it was given in Scotland. I don't know how clear it is looking at this in these two slides, but seeing this in the conservation studio, one of the things that struck us was how much better, how much tighter this composition was without that margin that sort of just wandered off into space. Suddenly, you got a sense of how the artist framed the picture himself, which was great. Even more importantly, most of the damages to this picture were in peripheral areas and just little sort of bits of static. And it cleaned up beautifully. Instead of this kind of yellow murk of clouds under the vision of the Christ child, there are these beautiful pinks and blues and pastel tones in this cloud, which aren't, I realize, entirely visible in the slide, but you can go upstairs and see them. There are no problems. I mean, I suppose if you're not accustomed to seeing pictures in the middle of conservation treatments, this might look sort of horrifying with this, you know, big loss under the Saint's ear and this old loss through Christ's arm. But these are really relatively minor things. These are not losses that you wouldn't see in any painting of this date in any museum in the world. It's just that, generally speaking, these images are not shown to the public because, you know, people. It's best not to do this unless you're going to explain what's going on. This is a picture in a beautiful state of conservation, as it turns out, which cleaned up nicely, was repainted, and then we still had the framing issue to work out. And in every one of these treatments I'm going to discuss, I'll talk about the framing solution, which often goes hand in hand with the conservation treatment, for which we ordered a new frame, much lighter than the old one, more historically appropriate in style to the picture, but with a very deep rabbet, so that those unpainted margins are now buried within the frame. And what you see through the window of the frame is just the original composition. This, as I say, is an example of a pretty straightforward, you know, unqualified success in a conservation treatment. But in many ways, this is the rarity. There always seem to be more issues and more decisions to be made. Such was the case when we began to look at this Kneeling Angel by Bernardo di Stefano Rosselli, a Florentine artist of the second half of the 15th century. This was a picture that we originally sent over to the conservation studio because as I began cataloging it, I actually had doubts as to whether it was, in fact, an authentic 15th century picture. I wondered whether this might be some sort of forgery, or how much of it was real and how much was repaint. One of the things that gave me pause was this dead, flat, black background, or almost black background, which I couldn't recall having seen in another Florentine picture of the 15th century anywhere in the world. It, too, was also very dirty. It hadn't really been treated in its history here. One of the nice things was that the moment it came out of its frame and backing board, and we could see the back of the panel and the construction of the wood, it was immediately clear that this was no forgery. It had, you know, obviously a panel of some age, this beautiful dovetailed batten. This is sort of what I mean by a dovetailed batten, something that was used by Florentine carpenters to hold pictures together when they were composed of many planks of wood. Nicely carved, obviously missing its batten, But also the fact that it was down here towards the bottom of the picture indicated to us immediately that there was a lot more of this picture, because the battens would be sort of set at the midpoint or at one-third and two-thirds of the way through. There's no point in putting a batten down at the bottom because the top of the planks would have warped. It was also clear, though, that this thing had been cut on all four sides. And as we began cleaning it, a few other things showed up. It's kind of great when you get a phone call. You got to come over. I found a tip of a wing. This is the sort of thing that gets me excited and gets a conservator excited. Wow, a wing tip. So we found at the very top of the paddle this little tip of a red wing. But also that awful flat blackish background had been used to cover over something interesting, which was this ghost of a shape, which in this slide is traced so that you can see it better. These white lines don't exist on the panel, but there's an underlayer of blue azurite paint, and then a thicker layer between the edge of that margin and out here. And if you look at this, you recognize it pretty quickly as the profile of a tabernacle frame of the late 15th century in Florence. So what does this all add up to? Well, looking at other works by Bernardo di Stefano Rosselli, you see, for example, in the altarpiece at Princeton, that wingtip is one of these seraphim, slightly silly, I realize, but this is the convention for painting seraphim, that are everywhere in his works. So that tip of wing meant that there was even more missing from the top of that picture. Also, Bernardo di Stefano was someone who, for many provincial churches in the 1470s, made a series of what we called altar surrounds, where you take an old icon, small, old, revered icon, you put it in a frame, and you stick that to a picture, and you make new saints and angels in adoration of it. So here, although it's missing its wooden frame that once unified the old icon and Bernardo di Stefano's surround, you see what I mean. This is a picture from a century later by the artist Francesco Vanni, but again, you see, here's the frame affixed to the front of the picture with the medieval icon in the middle and a modern surround. This is one of the ways of updating church decorations while also preserving a quote-unquote miraculous icon, or an icon, or an older picture that's an object of some devotion. And it was clear that the kneeling angel with its tabernacle frame had once been part of just such a picture, with the angels in adoration probably of a virgin and child image that would have sat in the middle. This is the far right edge of the altarpiece, almost certainly, and that there would have been an equal and opposing angel on the other side. There would have been seraphim somehow across the top of that tabernacle, perhaps more than one, given that it was off-center. And there almost certainly were a number of other saints along the bottom margin. Now, I have had no success in trying to locate any of the other fragments of this picture, which must have been done and probably do survive, because it's very rare that one fragment survives and others don't. Bernardo di Stefano Rosselli is hardly a household name, even among art historians, though there's no catalog of his works. One hopes that in publishing the catalog, someone will make the connections and say, this is probably another piece and all of that. I've long wondered, actually, whether Bernardo di Stefano, who is an artist responsible for these updatings of old pictures, might have been the painter responsible in Florence in the 1470s for cutting down Giotto's Baroncelli altarpiece, originally a big Gothic polyptych with pinnacles and a predella and everything, which in the 1470s was put in this Renaissance frame and had the addition of our friends the red-winged seraphim shoved into what had been the spaces between the pinnacles. So what you see here is our Giotto, as it hangs upstairs, replaced on top of the picture from which it came. And I think that substitution and that reframing may have been done by Bernardo di Stefano. There's no documentation to prove this. I also thought it was interesting, though, to bring in the Giotto to go down a bit of a tangent down those lines. Because here's our Giotto in a 1940s photograph, and as you see it now. Now, interestingly, There was no one here in Southern California to restore pictures at the time this was done in the 1940s, so it was sent to that most active, most important of conservation studios at the time, the Yale University Art Gallery Laboratory, where Andy Petrin, the same man who treated all the Yale pictures, was also instructed to deal with the Giotto from San Diego. This 19th century base, obviously not original to the picture because the picture was part of this huge altarpiece which remains in Santa Croce in Florence, but the 19th century base that was once anchored at the bottom of the picture so that it could sit on the mantelpiece in the home of Bernard Berenson's brother Arthur, is gone. And this is something we never would do today. I mean, this thing was cut off and tossed aside, tossed into some scrap heap for lumber. All we know of it is what you can see in this photograph. It's actually sort of interesting because in the passage you can puzzle out in a better photograph, it's an excerpt from Dante about light and vision from the Paradiso, which actually is historically contemporary with the painting of the picture, which is also about an idea of light and vision, theologically speaking. So whenever this thing was made, someone did it in the full knowledge of what this vision of the apocalypse was getting at, which is kind of fascinating and historically interesting, and one wishes it were never tossed away. Now, there's a kind of intellectual weakness to Petrin's treatment here, though, because on the one hand, they tossed out what was not original, but then replaced the original, you see, somewhat battered molding at the outside of the picture, with this clean, sharp, shiny, new molding on the outside. And I don't see how intellectually you put these things together. And this is what I mean, where, you know, it's not just a matter of making a picture look better, but there's no consistency of purpose, there's no consistency of ideal in how this work was treated. Getting back to Bernardo Di Stefano, once the picture is cleaned and inpainted, when the losses are painted back out, which turned out not to be, well, you know, Alexis might disagree, turned out I thought not to be too complicated to do, we then had several decisions to make. What do you do about the wingtip up at the top, which had been painted over? Do you leave this little fragment of what the picture might once have been showing? Because isn't that kind of confusing to people? Do you leave the shadow of the tabernacle frame, which you can't recreate, you can't do a photo montage and show what was originally there? The decision we made, which I'm sure that some of my colleagues in some museums would criticize, is that yes, I think there's no way to get around the fact that this work is a fragment. To turn it back into an independent picture of an angel is, to me, the same sort of intellectual weakness that was used in the half-hearted treatment of the Giotto. It is a fragment. And leaving this and this, which can be explained even in a label of 150 words, I think actually tells a more interesting story about the picture in a way. It lets the viewer understand what this work of art really is without, I think, being a horrible visual distraction. There are two other things that we wondered about. One is this drip of blue paint that goes across the back of the angel's drapery, which looked like blue paint, originally seemed to be blue paint from that unifying of the background that had dripped. But in fact, this is original paint. This was a fragment of a very tall altarpiece for almost certainly a dark church in the Florentine hinterland. And Bernardo Di Stefano was a little sloppy because he could, because no one was ever going to get within 8 feet of this part of the painting. And so when the background dripped as he was painting it across the drapery, he left it. So we did too. On the other hand, when he was painting the seraphim with his vermilion red up top, a lot of the paint splattered. And there are little pinpoints of red all over the painting, one of which sat just on the tip of the angel's nose. Now, when this thing is in a dark church and a mile up in the air, no one could ever possibly have seen that. When the nose is at your eye level in the gallery and you're looking at the painting, we felt like it was almost the only thing that you could see, you know, the angel with the zit on his nose. So I hope no one will think us having been too rash and just touching that back a little bit so it didn't become a visual distraction that kind of subverted your appreciation of the painting as a whole. All of this, of course, is documented and reversible. And there's no great argument for doing this or not, but it is a case of steering away from your standard course just to make something that works visually in the context of a modern art gallery. This is what I mean about not holding too hard to your methodologies. You have to fudge things once in a while. But these issues of how to present fragments are interesting ones because this collection, like most museums, has a number of 15th century paintings and earlier paintings that are fragments of much larger works. When in the 18th and 19th centuries these old works were moved out of the churches and replaced by modern paintings, the easiest way to sell them to your British and American tourists was by cutting them into things of domestic scale that could be taken home and installed in a Boston living room or a university gallery. That's certainly the case with this St. Peter. Another work of deeply uncertain attribution. This picture had never been touched since the time it came in the 20s. I think you can see in these slides just how dirty the varnish is. Look at the gray drapery and these sort of clouds of yellow filth on them. You can also see that it has old scratches across the surface. You can't see in the slide, I don't think, but there was a kind of horribly fudged, gummed up area of the yellow brocade down in the corner. It had this relatively cheap and ugly early 20th century frame, and the picture didn't sit straight. So you see that the columns and the lines were kind of askew in this frame, which was slightly disturbing when you stood in front of the picture, vertigo inducing. On the other hand, I thought this was a picture that had real moments of true subtlety in painting, real quality in painting, looking at the drapery and the kind of shading that you could sort of puzzle out even beneath the murk of old varnish and dirt. I thought this would be something worth investigating. We still didn't know who had painted it. It had been attributed long ago to the so-called master of Astorga, so-called because this altarpiece in the Cathedral of Astorga, in northwestern Spain, by an unknown artist, seemed to be by the same person who painted this. I actually don't think it's the same one. I think the similarity is simply that the master of Astorga in this altarpiece and in another one that's in Barcelona liked in his bottom row of the reticule to paint paired saints, often framed by arches or with an arch in the middle. So here are three examples, here's a fourth example. Obviously, this is half of an arch, and presumably there was going to be another saint on the left side. And again, no one has ever connected this up to anything. So we still don't know who painted it, but that's kind of not our purpose in worrying about that. Is not our purposes today. But boy, did it begin to clean up. Yes, the cleaning revealed old scratches, but those were perfectly visible in the old paint as well, because the paint that had been used to cover those over in the early 20s had discolored and no longer matched the surrounding surface. So yeah, it's a little horrifying to see that. But you also see, and this is just a first pass, I mean, this is not even completely cleaned, but suddenly there's light and air in this picture. It's interesting that Betsy started cleaning this from right to left, because one of the questions that we had is, well, this is the midpoint of the arch is sort of here, and what were we going to find? Were we going to find part of another saint there? And then as the cleaning proceeded, yes, indeed, there was another saint there, part of whom had literally been chiseled off the panel, I mean, had been scraped from the panel. Other parts, his red knee down here, survived. Now, the picture came to life in the cleaning, and the painting of the drapery and the colors suddenly were beautiful. It had all these fantastic little touches, which were invisible before, like these little archways underneath the base of the column. I mean, it's a completely frivolous detail, but it was something that just showed this was a painter paying attention. He wasn't some hack going through the motions. The very subtle shading that we start to see under the arches, the gold details in these column capitals. It still present us with the problem, though, of what do you do about the red knee that remains of the former fragment? There are sort of two solutions. One is you return it to how it had looked before and just paint this with the continuation of the gray architecture and the continuation of the gold brocade. Or do you leave it and try to show it as a fragment with the fragmentary remains of the other saint? Now, one of the other things that happens, or one of the other considerations, though, is keep in mind how this picture had sat crookedly in its frame so that you couldn't actually read it. Here you get that original image again. If you put it back in its frame, it's still going to sit crooked and it'll be cleaner, but it'll still be somewhat vertigo-inducing because the vertical lines of the picture don't line up with those in the frame. So the solution we took here, and I think it's a good one, is to treat the fragment as a fragment. Just have these, what we call a kind of pie hole, a pie plate holder mount, hold it on the walls of the gallery. You can see how the panel is skewed. But leave that red knee. Again, acknowledge the fragment as a fragment. Don't try to turn this into an individual picture. I mean, I think everyone who visits a museum is smart enough to look at this, or if they're curious and don't realize just in first glance that it's a fragment, read the label where this is explained. That's the decision we made. Apart from that decision, though, I think there still is, when you see the juxtaposition of the pre-treatment and post-treatment, an unqualified success in bringing literally back to light this picture, which otherwise was eminently forgettable because you just had no sense of its merits underneath all of that dirt and varnish. Now, these are treatments we began. There's also occasionally an argument for not starting a treatment. This tondo, which was acquired as a work by Piero di Cosimo for some time, it was recognized that it's not quite by Piero di Cosimo. I actually now think, I'm now relatively certain that it's by an artist named Bugiardini, who was a follower of Piero di Cosimo, whose slightly squashed profiles of young children are unmistakable once you've seen one and connect it to the name. This is one of a number of works that were treated in the 1970s by a restorer named Ben Johnson up in LA, who used synthetic varnishes that were then relatively new and which haven't withstood the test of time so well. Not only have those synthetic varnishes gone cloudy, but also they, in many cases, have started to delaminate the paint. The varnish is literally pulling the paint from the surface. And so at some point, before I arrived in San Diego, a number of test patches had been opened up in this painting. That's what you see with these little open windows here and here. Someone had thought, well, could we do something to improve the appearance of this painting? And then stopped. Who knows why? Now, we had a number of works out on loan. I was sort of desperate for another Renaissance picture to fill in the gaps in the gallery. It's not a great painting, but it's far from terrible. It has a nice gold tondo frame as well. So let's send it over to BACC and see what we can do. Is it a matter just of kind of closing these test patches? But before we decide that, let's do a bit of technical examination and see what we can find out. We discovered a number of interesting things, one of which was that the painter who made this panel really did not know how to draw hands. It's sort of comical to see, because you can look at this with an infrared camera and see the underdrawing and see how when he got to the hands, he just sort of fudged the drawing and then fudged the painting on top of that. So you've got these indeterminate claws here. We also somewhat distressingly realized that all of the browns in the picture were repaint, that the original browns, which are often fragile pigments, which get cleaned off, in the hair of all of these angels, for example, this was all repaint. And that if we began cleaning the painting, all of this would have to be repainted, redone again. And the best you could hope to do was to match up to the probably 19th century restoration that had put that hair on in the first place. And so it's not a minor job. It actually would become a fairly major treatment for a fairly minor painting. And yes, I suppose in the abstract, if time and money were limitless, you could take something like this on. But it's a case where we instead just decided to reform the varnish to close up the holes and put the picture on view as it was, despite its yellowed varnish, just because there was just nothing to justify right now, when there are so many other things to be worked on, opening up this horrible can of worms, which might have wound up looking a bit like the Yale Giovanni Bellini before you started putting it back together. There are, though, other times where it is absolutely sensible to redo old restorations, such as was the case with this picture, now attributed to Sofonisba Anguissola, formerly attributed to Sanchez Coelho. That the subject of the reattribution is a whole other story, which I've told before, not going to tell now. But looking at this picture, or looking at the detail, which maybe is fuzzy and not entirely clear, it had, among other things, this old rip that had been patched and which was bubbled up on the surface. You can sort of see how the background, which had had these flake losses which had been repaired, the repairs had changed color over time. So you had all this static of miscolored retouching. It was also under a clouded varnish, so that the picture just didn't seem to have any life, didn't have any air to it, didn't have any snap to it. And then looking at the bottom edge, I think you can see, even from the farthest row of the auditorium, that the hand was pretty horribly fudged when someone had reconstructed it. It's inconceivable that the artist who painted a head of such subtlety could have painted so lobster-clawed a hand. So conservation began, because I think actually this is a very important painting. And we determined that despite the damage along the bottom, most of the other damage was secondary. It was all out here in the margins of the painting, with, you know, one little loss in the face and some through the body. But, you know, most of this was just a matter of cleaning and reuniting the losses with the surface, the original surface. We also discovered that the painting had been stretched crookedly in a previous conservation treatment. So it was, again, a bit like the St. Peter, where you had a slight vertigo because the picture sat slightly crookedly on its stretcher. In order to repair that rip and the huge loss, which turned out not to be painting lost from the canvas, but actually the original canvas was cut along this ratty bottom edge. It had probably been damaged. In order to repair this, we had to start by relining the work. That is to say, taking the original canvas and attaching it to a new backing canvas, which would allow it to be stretched with tension so that it could all stay in plane. This is always a bit of a drastic treatment. Now it is done on a vacuum table. In the past, it was done by putting the painting face down and ironing with a heavy iron a new canvas onto the back, which obviously crushed the paint surface and often meant that the glue from the relining went through the front of the picture and caused all sorts of other problems. That's not the case any longer. Some of you will hear about how relining is a horror. It's not that bad. And then the issue of starting to reconstruct the losses, but especially difficult was the matter of the hand. Now, your first recourse is the photographs, the very good detailed photographs of what that hand had looked like before you began cleaning the old repaint away. Except in this case, that was more or less useless to us, because we didn't want to go back to that incompetently painted hand. So the solution was to call in Captain America and his platypus. And this is a young boy posing, a boy who turns out to be more or less exactly the age that the princeling was when he was painted, just posing to give another bit of evidence for reconstructing the light and shadow and angle of this hand. It didn't work perfectly the first time. So here's the first completed photo of, or a photo of the first completed restoration. And although the hand was a little bit more convincing than the old one had been, it still just didn't seem to sit right in space. And so we took another crack at it, and I think it's a very subtle difference, and again, maybe more or less invisible looking at it in many times magnified slides, but by bending that finger back, and in fact, I think Jack was brought in at that stage between the first and the second hand to pose for a crooked small finger here and how the light would fall, suddenly it makes much more sense. And I think the result is an unqualified success. The picture now does look like the major work of art it is, rather than something that the museum couldn't have cared less about for 80 years, leaving it in that horrible situation. And I want to finish with this picture, which presents maybe the most complicated series of issues of any of the treatments that we've set out. It's a work, it's a picture of Saint Jerome with his lion kneeling in the wilderness from the circle of Pietro Perugino, that artist of Umbria and Florence around the year 1500, which had previously been identified as a workshop picture. And in fact, the label I wrote for it several years ago read as follows. The key bit is what I've highlighted in yellow, yet there's an element of pastiche here for Perugino's own images of Saint Jerome staring upward. Have him staring up at a small cross or crucifixion in the tree, whereas here the object of Jerome's gaze is instead just the tree. Variations of this sort are in typical workshop practice. It was a dumb picture. Saint Jerome penitent staring up into the trees isn't a subject that you find in Italian Renaissance art. It seemed to be a workshop assistant misunderstanding what the picture was about. Despite all of that, despite the fact that it was a workshop picture, seemed to be a workshop picture, and again, a relatively minor work, it was something we thought would clean up beautifully, and that instead of these discolored repairs, you see these stripes, for example, in Jerome's chest, these are old repairs. You know, and obviously the retouching paint doesn't age the same way that the original paint does, so it changes color over time. You know, and kind of generally gummed up yellow varnished surface, we thought this would clean up wonderfully. Alas, it turned out to be more damaged than we originally had anticipated. Still, it was worth proceeding. One of the most interesting things, the most interesting thing we discovered, though, was that up at that tree where the saint stares, there was this big loss here. Now, these are old splits in the panel. The damage follows cracks in the wood as the wood panel warped. This, however, with its sharp side, seemed to be a mechanical removal, that someone seems to have kind of gone in there and taken something out. And under the microscope, there were little gold lines that suddenly showed up in here, completely invisible in this slide. You'll have to take my word for it. Little gold lines that said, oh, wait, Jerome didn't stare dumbly upward into the leaves of the trees. He must have stared upward at one of these crosses up in the tree, the way that you expect him to do in a picture like this. And in, I don't know, some sort of weird version of Protestant American taste in the early 20th century, that cross was removed and you were just left with the heroic saint in the wilderness. I can't justify this choice. So we began thinking, well, can we reconstruct the cross? What do we do with this hole? Do we return this to being a dumb picture of Saint Jerome staring at nothing? Or knowing that the cross was there because we have the evidence of the loss and the little gold rays, can we find a parallel picture and begin to reconstruct it? So, you know, here are other pictures from Perugino and his workshop. I mean, you can sort of, I think, see the immediate similarities between a picture like this down to the folds of the drapery and that weird toe that the saint has staring upward at a cross here or one here. And as I began flipping through these photos, Perugino workshop, anonymous Umbrian Saint Jerome's, in the phototeca of the art historian Federico Zeri, which is now his old photo collection is now online, scanned with his notes, I came across this photo, which shows our picture as it looked in the 19th century before restoration, probably in 1920 or so. And look there, up in the sky, is our cross. So on the basis of this black and white photo, which actually is slightly blurry here, but was clearer than it seems, on the basis of this photo and these other pictures which help with color schemes, we eventually came to the reconstruction of the cross in the sky, as well as the unification of the old losses and the generally more clean and airy appearance of the picture, which was much improved apart from that. Now, this might seem controversial to some people. Can you fabricate a cross like this? And I think you have to ask yourself not what the truth of the situation is, but what the alternatives were. You could leave it as a whole. That's what, you know, Charles Seymour would have had you do at Yale in 1955. You would have just had this battered picture with a hole in the middle of it. You could restore it to the way it was restored for someone with an agenda in 1920 or so, or you could present it in a way that got back to its likely original appearance as recorded in that old photograph. And I think that third option was the only sensible one for us in the end. At the same time, though, as the wall label upstairs reads, this cross is a reconstruction based on old photographs and a recent restoration. There's no attempt to hide this from anyone. And I think this idea of when you have the evidence to reconstruct something, you do that. That's the prevailing attitude. To take an even more dramatic example, here's a Carlo Crivelli. Some of you know I have a thing for Carlo Crivelli at the National Gallery in London, as it looked 10 years ago, and as it was in the middle of its conservation treatment, showing the full extent of the damage, and then as it was reconstructed by the conservators in the lab at London. It actually doesn't hang with the bare wood showing. This is a photo. These are photos taken in the conservation studio, and it has a frame that covers the wood. I don't think this solution is any more or any less radical than that which we used for the Little Saint Jerome. I think this is a good solution. And just as we're talking about this now, and just as this, the details of our conservation treatment will be in the catalog, which will show the photo of it from the black and white, as well as from its strip state, so too the National Gallery is publishing its evidence so as not to deceive anyone and give more and more information to scholars, give more information to who's curious, but at the same time present something that in the gallery gives you Carlo Crivelli more or less without visual distraction. So I think in conclusion, the takeaway lessons here are, one, almost never are things as simple as they seem, but that you can't set yourself up with a methodology and follow that at the cost of reasonable judgment. Fragments can be differently fragmented. You can make different decisions from one fragment to the next, although it is also helpful as you work through one collection to present things in a relatively consistent way so that once someone has understood why you're showing a fragment in the first picture, they don't have to re-engage with that question on the second, third, and fourth picture in that gallery, which they see presented as a fragment. I think another one of the key lessons here is the interaction of the curators and the conservators. I think you have a sense of how much we went back and forth and talked about the decisions and their cleaning, and I'm doing research and trying to find out what these pictures look like, and we're making decisions together, and I think that's the only sensible way for these things to proceed. It's a pattern of constant learning and I think constant fascination. I mean, these are always new and interesting puzzles, as I hope they've been to you today. There are still others to come. These two pictures, and I'm sorry for these horrible photographs, which were both part of one altarpiece originally, but framed very differently, also entirely untouched from their arrival here in 1950, are currently over in the middle of a conservation treatment. And there are still more technical examinations to be done. The great Goya portrait, for example, remains with this cloud of pentiment in the background, which has never been x-rayed, and which at some point I hope we'll figure out what was going on here in the original version of this picture. But my last word, though, as I say, is the same as my first word, which is to give thanks to my colleagues over at the Balboa Art Conservation Center, because I might be the mouthpiece for this talk, but everything that you're seeing today is their work as much as mine. Thank you.
Sure. Well, this was truly enlightening, and I can't wait for part two, I hope, next year. But John agreed to have a little bit time for some questions.
One of the problems with 19th century paintings was that they used a black underpainting with bitumen in it, and it has come forward and darkened the paintings. I was in France recently, and a curator at a museum there showed us a painting that they had lightened, And I wonder if you know anything about that technique and if it's going to be available to us soon.
I don't know about the treatment you're talking about specifically. I think it tends to be, it's not as though bitumen was universally used in this way. I think some of those older French museums went through periods where every picture in the building was restored in the late 19th century, just as the Louvre relined everything in the late 19th century when the relining of pictures was suddenly a kind of craze. I don't think it's something, it's not something that I can think of as affecting works here. That we have other issues, but that's not one of them. I mean, we have a number of pictures that were treated by this guy up in LA in the 50s, which all have delaminating hard synthetic varnish problems, which need to be treated at some point. All of these treatments take time and they take money. I know that this is not necessarily the place to get into this, but I've long said that it's extremely unusual that a museum of this size with a collection of this size doesn't have a conservation studio in-house where things can be worked on systematically over time. That's something that one would hope to see change someday, I guess. I'm sorry, that's not really the answer to your question, but I don't have one.
I saw that in the interest of time, you had skipped over the Fra Angelico.
I knew someone was gonna come back to that. I knew it.
Because it's just, I was here when that change was effected and looked into it quite a bit. What I got from my research there was that there were certainly technical issues that were clearly addressable. You could really address them. But at a certain point, I know Lawrence Cantor applied the concept of connoisseurship to these kinds of issues.
Right.
And I think that when you say that the curator has to work with the conservationist, one of the issues that you talk about is connoisseurship and how much that adds to the decisions that you make.
Well, I mean, these are parallel issues. Connoisseurship in this case was a matter of, is this a work by the early Lorenzo Monaco or is it a work by the early Fra Angelico? That's the connoisseurial question over this. And there is nothing that you will find in the picture from a technical point of view that will determine one versus the other. Fra Angelico started his career in Lorenzo Monaco's studio, so he uses the same materials, he uses them the same way. It's more a question of the mind at work behind the painting. The conservation issue that figures into that story is that the coat of arms at the bottom of the picture, this coat of arms, the original coat of arms, had been covered over with a different coat of arms at some point. And that when this one was discovered, and it means that the picture was painted for the Alberti family, that determines the date at which the picture was probably done, which then suggests that it's a picture of 1411 or 12, at which point it can't, Lorenzo Monaco's a different artist by that point. So it's either Lorenzo Monaco in the 1390s or it's Fra Angelico, 1411, 12, something like that. And so that's how conservation gets in. What I was gonna talk about briefly was the issue of framing. Coming on the heels of presenting this as a fragment, I hate this frame. There, I've said it. Because this frame, with its red velvet liner, which would seem to be the historical artifact of its 19th century installation, was made in Los Angeles in 1973. It is a 1970s evocation of a frame of the 1870s. And yet the picture has its original frame. I mean, this obviously was the center of a small triptych, but it has its original engaged frame still perfectly intact. And to show it like that, freed of this, which is just meant to make it a bigger object on the wall to kind of demand that it be treated as important, this to me is a hell of a lot more satisfying than the historical falseness of this. I mean, again, this is what I get falls under the category of intellectual weakness in the presentation of pictures. I mean, if it had its 19th century frame and that were original, like the base of the Giotto, that's one thing. That's part of the history of the object. This, I don't consider the 1970 solution part of the history of the object. I wouldn't throw it away, but I certainly think that the picture would look better hanging on the wall without it.
Could it be fixed?
There. I've never been known for biting my tongue. We're going to have one follow-up, and then I think I have to send you off to your tours.
But could it be fixed?
What's that?
Could it be fixed?
It can. I mean, so about 2 weeks before I left, we did this big photographic campaign taking new high-risk photographs of the works for the purposes of my catalog. And it was at that point that we took this thing apart and realized that its original frame is perfectly intact, and it just pops out of the velvet box. I mean, you could hang this on the wall pretty simply. Whether my successors will choose to do so is up to them. Anyway, I've kept you for a very long time. You've been very patient. Thank you all for coming.